Yes. Bills Fanatics presents Trendsetters. I'm your host, A. Rich, Akeem Richens. If you don't know me, get to know me. You should get used to the saying. I say that a lot. That's kind of like my slogan. That's my thing to say. That's what I do. If you don't know me, get to know me. Trendsetters with Bills Fanatics. I hope everybody had a blessed week. I hope everybody had an enjoyable week, especially watching the transactions and the things that our team, the Buffalo Bills, was able to do this past week. We have been one of the busier teams this offseason than I can think of in past years. I've never seen our Buffalo Bills brass, our Buffalo Bills organization, this competitive this early in the offseason. I never seen us go toe to toe with other teams in the offseason, like a Chicago Bears or a Kansas City Chiefs that had a good offseason. The Jacksonville Jaguars, the New York Jets put together a decent offseason, in my opinion. But it's just refreshing for us, our team, our squad, to be just as aggressive as any other team in the National Football League. And I have to start off by giving credit where credit is due. The credit, it starts from the top. It starts from the ownership. I'm not sure what's going on with the Buffalo Sabres with Terry and Kim Pegula. I know they have their moments in hockey. I know they're hockey guys and gals, and they're struggling in that hockey frame. But in terms of the Buffalo Bills aspect, being in the football operations aspect, I have to give them their credit. I have to give them their just due. It starts with the ownership and reasons being why we can be so assertive and be so aggressive in this NFL offseason. I'm a little older. I'm in my early 30s. I'm approaching my mid 30s. I'm not going to give you my exact age. I still think I'm relatively young, but I've been a Buffalo Bills fan a while now. And I'm used to, I'm going to put it nicely, a more frugal, a more conservative bunch in terms of Buffalo Bills ownership, in terms of Buffalo Bills brass. I'm pretty sure this is a very interesting thing that Jim Oberdorf is going through. Jim Oberdorf, I believe he's an integral part in what we do in terms of our cap number and our cap spending. He's been a part of the organization for a number of decades now. And Jim Oberdorf has seen the sudden change. He's been a part of this 360-degree turnaround in terms of being frugal. Let's call a spade, being cheap with our late great owner Ralph Wilson, rest in peace. And he's turned it around and he's able to adjust. Of course, everybody want to keep their jobs. So you're going to do what you have to do to adjust anyway. But you have to give him credit as well for seeing how it's been from past to present. Now, we all know, at least the people my age, around my age and older, all know that although we adore Ralph Wilson, although we respect Ralph Wilson to the highest of regards, he wasn't a football guy. Let's just call a spade. He wasn't a football guy. He was more of a businessman. He was more of how I'm going to make myself money. I'm not necessarily concerned with the team's overall performance. I'm more concerned with my money and my pockets and fat I can get my pockets. So when we see a Ralph Wilson and we've seen how he was with the golden years with our Buffalo Bills franchise, where we went to four straight Super Bowl and lost, we didn't necessarily pick up any additions in that offseason that could have possibly got us over the hump. Am I right? For the Buffalo Bills in that early 90s, we didn't really capitalize on off seasons to help us beat a Washington Redskins team, to beat a Dallas Cowboy the second stint in the Super Bowl. We didn't make those necessary moves, and Ralph Wilson was more of a businessman than an owner, so to speak, than a football guy, so to speak. Ralph Wilson wasn't an Al Davis. Al Davis, Oakland Raiders, they just wanted to win. All he wanted to do was win football games, win championships. Al Davis was a surefire competitor that loved to compete and win. We had the total opposite in owners when it comes to Ralph Wilson. Ralph Wilson was more of a businessman. He was more of keeping guys' salaries intact, in order. He didn't really believe in raises. And it's been a very interesting article that came out. Y'all have to look at it, man. O.J. Simpson, he got to talk in a lot of ways that we're not accustomed to O.J. Simpson talking. Everybody that wants to talk to O.J. Simpson basically want to know, did you murder Nicole or you didn't murder Nicole? We kind of got away from how great a player O.J. Simpson was. We kind of got away from the football aspect, the football stories about O.J. Simpson because of his doings, his wrongdoings, and the situations he's been in. But if y'all got a chance, look up that article, and O.J. Simpson said a lot of interesting tidbits. And we're talking about back in the 70s, even before our time, my time, with Ralph Wilson and the Buffalo Bills. He has a lot of interesting things to say about the owner, and y'all definitely should take a look at it, man. O.J. Simpson really felt that the Buffalo Bills didn't win or take the necessary steps towards winning while he was with the organization is because of Ralph Wilson and his unwillingness to shed some money and his unwillingness to compete. And he had in that front office at the time in the 70s, he had a lot of businessmen that wasn't necessarily football guys. And when you have a game-changing player like O.J. Simpson, we're talking about a guy that had 2,000 yards rushing in 1973. 1973, in a 14-game schedule, a 14-game season, O.J. Simpson had 2,000 rushing yards. 1975, he had over 1,800 rushing yards, over 2,000 yards from scrimmage. That might have been an even better season than the one he had in 1973. O.J. Simpson, we're talking about a man that won 4 rushing titles, 5 All-Pros, was a league MVP, and in yet 8 seasons, he was only able to obtain 1 postseason out of 8 years. And he contributed a lot of that to Ralph Wilson and his frugalness, so to speak, in terms of spending money or the lack of spending money. And he made a lot of interesting comments. I know at the time his GM, look at the article, his agent was trying to explain to Ralph Wilson that we have a game-changing player. And Ralph Wilson said, basically said, he's not concerned with championships. When you're winning championships, when you're winning games, everybody's going to want raises. Everybody's going to want more money. And if you want raises, you want more money, you start winning championships and more games, you have no choice but to add that revenue. And Ralph Wilson, he just wasn't about that at that time. As we all know, it seems as if when everybody gets older, I know my mama did it, I'm pretty sure a lot of y'all mamas did it, they was really strict when they was younger, right? A lot of people was really strict when they was younger. I know my brother, he has his jealous tendencies of me because he was the first one that came out. My mother was a little older when she had me, so she was a little bit more lenient towards me. And that seems like what Ralph Wilson was going through. During his younger days as an owner, he was real frugal from back in the 70s all the way to the 90s. But as he got older, right, as Ralph Wilson started getting sick, he started getting older, what happened? He started to become a little more lenient. Let's give him some credit. He became a little more lenient the older he got. As much as he was strict back in the day, the older he got, the more lenient he became before he died. So I give him that in that retrospect. But we could say that with a lot of our mothers and our fathers today. My mother was a lot more lenient towards me, God rest her soul, before she passed, than when I was first born. So that's kind of like the same wavelength Ralph Wilson was going through. And to come back and to get guys like a Terry and Gauss, like a Terry and like a Kim Pagula, is a breath of fresh air. We have owners now in today's game that's not bashful and is not going to shy away for spending money when necessary. They're not going to shy away to spend money to make the organization better, to make the team better, and to make the fans happier. So I have to congratulate Tim and Kerry Pegula for giving us that new revamped organizational structure that we didn't have back in the past. And because of that, we've had guys that come in, Doug Whaley, that can come in now. Started with him. He started spending money. He started spending money, crazy money. He didn't necessarily have an idea of how he was spending the money. He didn't have the forward thinking process of spending the money now and what will happen in the future. But it started with Doug Whaley and spending the money. It started with the hiring of Rex Ryan. What are we used to? As longtime Buffalo Bills fans, I'm in my early 30s. I'm used to the Dick Girons as head coaches. I'm used to the Wade Phillips as head coaches. I'm used to the Chan Gailey's of the world as head coaches. Why? We have to get those kind of third-tier head coaches. Wade Phillips is a top-flight defensive coordinator, but third-tier head coaches, because our ownership, our brass, didn't want to spend that necessary money to get the proper guys in place. And now that you have guys that's willing to spend money, our attitude has changed a little bit. The culture has changed a little bit. A lot of talk back in the day was nobody wanted to go to Buffalo because Buffalo was too cold. Buffalo wasn't a desirable destination. Buffalo was 8 hours away from the city. But you are going to factor those things in when your organization, when your brass is not willing to spend top flight money, when your organization is not willing to spend them dollar amounts. Now that we're willing to spend the dollar amounts, we can get certain guys. All of a sudden, it's not so cold in Buffalo. All of a sudden, Buffalo's not that far away from New York City. We can get movie stars like a Rex Ryan. You notice I said movie stars, right? Yes. We can get movie stars like a Rex Ryan. We can add in a Sean McDermott and pay him 5 years, knowing that we still had to pay Rex Ryan for his wrongdoing, right? We was able to still come out and get a guy like Sean McDermott. We was able to couple up Sean McDermott with a Brandon Bean. And now all of a sudden, because we are not as frugal, we're not as bashful with our money, we're starting to see some aggressive results. Am I right? So that's very important, man. That is an essential part of the process. Is our ownership, is Terry and Kim Pegula. Now, we made an excellent point. Bobby, Pierre, Rico, shout everybody on the team out. We made an excellent point on our post a couple days ago on our Instagram story. And the quote was stated as, "We're creating the bully. Sean McDermott is creating that bully that Rex Ryan was talking about creating." And that is an excellent, excellent point. Sean McDermott is bringing in that bully. He's coupled up with a hell of a GM, Brandon Bean. Now, I like Doug Whaley. I really like Doug Whaley and what he was able to do. He wasn't scared to spend money. I just don't think he had the forward thinking process down packed. He was the type of guy that would spend money but not really look to the future. Doug Whaley was like a bad toothache. He was like your wisdom tooth coming in, right? Doug Whaley, your wisdom tooth coming in. You don't want to get that wisdom tooth pulled. So what you going to do? You're going to pop a bunch of Tylenol. You're going to pop a bunch of Advil, Excedrin, aspirin. And you're going to get that temporary relief. But at the end of the day, that toothache was still going to come back. And now with the bad contracts with Doug Whaley was doing, he was trying to give our Buffalo Bills organization some temporary relief by extending guys, by restructuring guys. But even if you restructure, guys, it may work for the now. It may work for the this year, but next year is going to come back to haunt you again. The year after is going to come back to haunt you again. So I compare Doug Whaley into equivalent to pulling out your wisdom tooth. Eventually, you're going to have to get your wisdom tooth pulled and stop playing around with this temporary relief. And in comes Brandon Bean. In comes Sean McDermott, and you. In comes Sean McDermott, and now we look like we're covering ourselves in all areas of the game. Now, don't get me wrong. Let me state this and get this out the way. The game's got to be played. The game's got to be played. Games are won and lost on the football field. The results ultimately happens on the football field. So we're not going to take nothing away from that. We have a lot of people, a lot of fans that get emotional ties to certain players. We have, I know myself, I had an emotional tie to Stevie Johnson. Stevie Johnson was my guy. Shady McCoy is my guy. I love those players. Those are two of my favorite players. And I was heartbroken. I was distraught when we got rid of a Stevie Johnson. I was hurt in thinking about the possibility of the Buffalo Bills possibly trying to move Shady McCoy. But at the end of the day, I'm a Buffalo Bills fan first. Let's not get married into players. Let's not get married and get our feelings caught up into these players where we lose sight of the bigger picture. We are team first. At least I am. At least that's how I thought it should be. It should be team first, player second. So as much as I love Stevie Johnson, as much as I love the Shady McCoy, as much as I feel that Sammy Watkins is an elite talent in this league, we have to do what's best for our football team. And if that goes to getting rid of players we like for the end of result is winning, that's what it's all about. It's team first, individual second. So I just felt it was necessary to get that out of the way. It was necessary to say that because a lot of us get caught up in players and we get caught up in our own feelings. We are not the GMs. We are not the guys making the calls. If we was the guys making the calls, it would be a different story. So let's stick with our team and let's love our team and appreciate the players that we have now while they're on the team and congratulate them and wish them all success if and when they leave the team. But getting back to a Brandon Bean and Sean McDermott, what we was able to do this offseason, in my opinion, is nothing short of brilliance. Again, the games have to be won or lost in the field, but it's nothing short of brilliance compared to what we did in years past. What we did in years past, it seems like Brandon Bean said, you know what? What Doug Whaley did? What Buddy Nix did? What this guy did, you know what? We're going to do the exact opposite of what the Buffalo Bills fans are used to. And that's going out and getting Avante Davis. We went out and before free agency started, we have holes within that secondary. We had a little inkling maybe that EJ Gaines was not going to be re-signed. So we was proactive in getting Avante Davis. Then we turned around and got a Chris Ivory. Chris Ivory was cut from the Jacksonville Jaguars. We was able to go and get a compliment back for LeSean McCoy. A lot of people will say, well, we could have got DeMarco Murray. We could have got this guy. We could have got that guy. I like, personally, Chris Ivory. I like the number we got Chris Ivory for, and I think it's a very good depth signing. We turn around. We're trying to find our next gems, right? We're trying to find our next diamond in the rough. Nobody thought Jordan Poyer would be the guy he was this year. Nobody thought that Jordan Poyer can come in and play at a Pro Bowl level like he did. He had his lacerated kidney. He was coming from a Cleveland Brown organization that everybody feels, calling a spade, that everybody feels is a joke around the NFL. So when you couple a guy that's coming from a lacerated kidney and he's coming from the Cleveland Browns, and a lot of us fans was skeptic in terms of signing a player like this on a multi-year deal. What did he do? He came out and played at a Pro Bowl, in my opinion, level. I know he didn't make the Pro Bowl, but he played at the Pro Bowl level, and he was a diamond in the rough. And I think we're trying to do that with certain guys now. We're trying to resurrect Avante Davis. We're trying to resurrect a Chris Ivory. Odigizua. I got it right. Third time. Owa Odigizua. Another guy that's been a freakish athlete. Former third round pick from the New York Giants. We need pass rushing ability. We need to improve on that pass rush. We didn't have the $100 million we may have next year in 2019 or 2020. So let's see if we can find another diamond in the rough. And Odigizua is possibly, I'm not going to say he is, but he could quite possibly be that diamond in the rough we was looking for. He could quite possibly be that Micah Hyde or Jordan Poyer. I like that signing because of his ability. At worst, he's a camp body. He doesn't hurt the structure of our football team. We didn't put out that much money into the guy, and we hope he pans out. We're talking about a low floor and high ceiling signing with this defense. We come around. How much balls do you have to have? It was a lot of talks that Brandon Bean was saying Tyrod Taylor is the guy for now. We're not going to necessarily get rid of a Tyrod Taylor unless we know for sure we can get something in return or we have something in return. But something came up, obviously, right? Cleveland Browns needed a quarterback. I feel that Hugh Jackson has no choice to do what he needs to do. Cleveland Browns was an 0 for last year. I'm pretty sure a lot of people in around the Cleveland organization, a lot of people around the Cleveland fan base have to be a certain percentage that wanted his job. So Hugh Jackson is of the win now. We know he knows that there's rookies coming out. He knows that there's talented rookies coming out, and he still might select a rookie. But he knows that he's not going to be around to develop that rookie he selects if he has another disappointing season. So he went out and he got a Tyrod Taylor, giving up the third round pick, 65th overall, the first pick in the third round. Now, I know Brandon Bean said he wanted to cover his I's and dot his T's. But when you have a third round pick, when a lot of people slotted Tyrod Taylor to be a release casualty, a lot of people thought that if he was to trade Tyrod Taylor, it would be for a fifth or a sixth round pick. When a third round pick comes up, when the first pick of the third round comes up, you cannot refuse that. And I love the aggressiveness in Brandon Bean to pull that trigger, knowing at the time he didn't have a quarterback besides Nathan Peterman on that roster. He made that bold move. I have to applaud the move. I have to applaud his assertiveness and what he was able to do to pull out a third round pick for a guy in Tyrod Taylor we definitely wasn't going to keep. So what we had to do, obviously we had to keep looking for our quarterbacks, right? A lot of guys was getting signed. A lot of people was running up to sign these players. Josh McCown signing a $10 million contract. Teddy Bridgewater signing a up to $15 million contract. Sam Bradford signing a $20 million contract with the Arizona Cardinals. Yo, whoever is Sam Bradford's agent, we have to go talk to this guy. We got to find out his secrets. I want to go to the school he went to study being an agent because he's doing a hell of a job. Sam Bradford can't stay healthy to save his life, but he continues to get elite starter money. Sam Bradford agent is a beast. Nevertheless, $20 million, $15 million, $10 million, Case Keenum getting $18 million. We're talking about guys that's getting paid elite money, and we already know their ceiling. We know what Josh McCown is. He's not going to get any higher. Sam Bradford is not going to get any higher. So what do Brandon Bean do? He took his methodical approach. He signed A.J. McCarron, who's been in the league 4 years. A lot of people say he's a career backup. A lot of people say he's not that good if he didn't beat out Andy Dalton. I don't know that yet. I don't know that. I didn't see a lot of people saying that about Jimmy Garoppolo. Maybe because it was Tom Brady. People felt that Jimmy Garoppolo could play, but he ain't going to start behind a Tom Brady. And Andy Dalton is an easy replacement. He may not be that easy if you're making $100 million. We don't know the exact reasoning behind the Cincinnati Bengals moves. All we do know is that Andy Dalton is a very expensive quarterback to leave on the bench. So what do Brandon Bean do? He brings in a wild card that could be a bridge. We as fans may look at him as a bridge. I know I look at the guy as a bridge guy. I know most fans look at him as a bridge guy. But at the end of the day, we don't know AJ McCarron's ceiling. We're not 100% on what AJ McCarron can do in the league. I'd rather not know what AJ McCarron can do than to already know what a Josh McCown can bring me. I know what he is. I know what he does. AJ McCarron, we don't know. He is what I call the wild card. And nevertheless, I still feel, I know a lot of us watch the Brandon Bean's press conference, and he said a lot of things. Brandon Bean has his way to saying a lot of things without saying anything. He is the master of that. But I do feel in my heart that we will still go out and get the quarterback of our liking, the quarterback that we feel can be the next franchise guy. So in my opinion, to sign an AJ McCarron, when you see all these contracts, to sign him for 2 years at $5 million a season is a damn steal. We ran in the bank and we stole a bunch of money from the bank, and there was nothing the bank can do about it. We don't know what AJ McCarron is, but at worst, he's the bridge guy for our franchise quarterback. So you have to love that move. Getting into some of our signings, our biggest signing, Star Latuale, 5 years, $50 million. I seen some gripe over that type of money. A lot of people feel that Star Latuale may got a little overpaid, but we have to look at what these players are. A lot of us fans may think defensive tackles are these new breeds, right? A lot of these new breeds, defensive tackles, Aaron Donalds, when Motron was Motron, when Darius was Darius, when Ndamukong Suh was Ndamukong Suh, before their big contract, we're talking about these defensive tackles getting 10 sacks from their position. Getting 10 sacks and double-digit sacks from a defensive tackle position is something that just started occurring in this NFL probably since 2010. Star Latuale is more of the older traditional defensive tackles. He's just as valuable as the other tackles. He just make himself an enforcer in a different way. He's a space eater. He's a space clogger. He's a powerful specimen that's going to clog these running lanes and make our linebackers get a lot of tackles, a lot of open field tackles. Again, we didn't fill that linebacker role. We need instinctive, explosive linebackers. But I really feel in my heart that we can get those linebackers, and that will make Star Latuale signing a greater signing. A powerful, explosive defensive tackle that's going to clog running lanes. This year, I don't see a team running the ball 22 or 26 consecutive times. With our revamped front four, we re-signed Kyle Williams. We have Jerry Hughes on one end. We signed Trent Murphy on the other end to go along with Jerry Hughes and Shaq Lawson. A lot of people may think, even if you listen to my pod last week, a lot of people may think that Jerry Hughes or Shaq Lawson is a casualty. Now, me personally, with the acquisition of a Trent Murphy and his high motor and what he's able to do, I love the wave of defensive linemen that can possibly come in. I love the fact that we have Shaq Lawson now, who's probably not the guy we drafted, but he could still set the edge. I love the fact that we still have Jerry Hughes. Hopefully bringing in Star Latuale can force some double teams and free him up some. Now, I like the acquisition of a high motor in Trent Murphy. You know what I love about Trent Murphy? Trent Murphy's natural position is a defensive end. He's naturally built as a defensive end coming from college as a second round pick. He getting thrust into this linebacker role for the Washington Redskins and he gets 9 sacks. We're talking about guys being system guys. We're talking about most of the NFL players at their positions are system players. This guy, Trent Murphy, is a natural defensive end that transitioned in the NFL as an outside linebacker and excelled at the linebacker position. 9 sacks in 2016 before he got suspended for four games for PEDs and he tore his ACL. We're talking about a guy that wreaked havoc as a linebacker, a position he's not accustomed to playing before he went to Washington. We've seen how much Jerry Hughes struggled trying to do that. We've seen how much the Indianapolis Colts felt that Jerry Hughes was possibly a bust because he was a defensive end coming from TCU and they tried to transition him to a linebacker and his numbers simply wasn't the same. We've seen how difficult it was for him. It wasn't that difficult for Trent Murphy. So that's why I really like that signing. Raphael Bush, another signing. He's probably not the best player, but he's definitely a good depth safety. He's a guy that's going to bring in leadership. He's going to bring in some intangibles. He's going to bring in some good depth. He was with the New Orleans Saints on 2 stints from 2012 to 15. He went to Detroit where he had his most playing time in 2016. 4 starts, 53 tackles, 1 sack, 2 interceptions, 3 passes defended. He had a solid year with the Detroit Lions coming back to the New Orleans Saints and really helping that secondary. Really helping that sink secondary. So I think he's going to provide that depth that we need. I don't want to see no Colt Anderson back there. We don't want to see, I like Pitts. I know we signed backup Pitts, but we much rather see a Raphael Bush than a Pitts back there in our defensive backfield. So in terms of depth in that signing, I really like that signing. Julian Stanford, the former linebacker from the New York Jets that played last year, said he came to the best fan base in the NFL. We lost Humbert. We're not going to miss him. We lost Preston Brown. I don't think we're going to miss him. Julian Stanford is not necessarily a starter. He doesn't have that starting experience, but he played 82% of his snaps on special teams. We know how much Sean McDermott feels special teams is important. We needed that signing. We needed that depth on special teams. Special teams is just as important as the other phases of the game. That's why we all say there's 3 parts of the game. Offense, defense, and special teams. So on the special teams aspect, I really like the Julian Stanford signing. I can't get mad at it at all. And last but not least, a lot of people feel that we're going to still move up in the draft. It's still possible that we moved up in the draft. I feel that way also. I still feel that way. But Brandon Bean, watching his press conference today, it's quite possible. Let me know what y'all think. I'm going to come back on Bills Fanatics. I'm going to have my Q&A live discussions. Let me know what y'all think after watching Brandon Bean's presser. Is it possible that we can stay put at number 12? Is it possible that we can keep all our picks? Now, we know we signed a lot of players. We know we improved in a lot of areas, but we did lose Preston Brown. We did lose him. We know we lacked depth at receiver. We didn't sign back any receivers. We got KB and say Zay Jones on the roster. I think it's a good start, but we still need more pieces there. When you look at the pieces we need at receiver, when you look at the pieces we need at linebacker, we filled up that running back depth. I know the running back class is real deep. I know we love a lot of our running backs in this class, but signing back a Tywan Jones and signing back a cadet along with Ivory, I really like the kid Green from TCU. I think he's going to surprise somebody, some teams. Surprise us in training camp. Along with LeSean McCoy, it's quite possible that we're done at running back. It's safe to say, matter of fact, that we're done at running back. But what about the other positions? We need multiple receivers. We need multiple linebackers. We need a quarterback. But with all these picks, is it possible that we stay at 12? Is it possible we keep all our picks, draft a quarterback from the 12th or 22nd position and keep the picks to fill out them other holes. Is it possible? I think it is. Brandon Bean does a great job of sounding believable. And the way he sounded, it's possible. Again, it could be some smoke, but it's possible. We can stay still, man. So let me get y'all feedback. I want to get y'all feedback during the week on what you thought about Brandon Bean's press conference and where you think we stand in the draft in terms of getting a quarterback. It all depends on how you feel about AJ McCarron. You see my boy Pierre, he put up the AJ McCarron playoff game in 2015. I know that he struggled in that playoff game 2015, but again, that was 2015. Is he the same player? I don't know. We beat Jimmy Garoppolo in 2014. Is he the same player in 2017? No, he is not that same player. So is it possible that AJ McCarron can improve his game? It is quite possible, but we're not going to know that until camp arrives. So we still going to have to get a QB either way. What direction are we going to take getting that QB? Staying still or moving up? And we definitely going to see. Once again, this A. Rich, Akeem Richens, Bills Fanatics presents Trendsetters. If you don't know me, get to know me. I'll be back 1:30 next Friday, Eastern Time. It's been a pleasure. Until next time.